Magandang umaga. We are continuing our study of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we're beginning the final two chapters. And so we will be in Thessalonians every week except for church camp weekend. So make sure you're at church camp. Pastor Ray will be preaching, right? No. I'm preaching, I guess. And we're going to have a good time. It's going to be a wonderful time together. So plan for church camp. But we're going to be continuing our study of 1 Thessalonians, and we will conclude that, our study of 1 Thessalonians, by the end of November, right before the month of December, when we're going to celebrate Christmas all month. Well, the stores are starting to celebrate now. We were at the mall yesterday doing some shopping, and we already started hearing the Christmas. I walk into this tech store and I'm hearing Christmas music. It's weird, but yeah, it's that time of the year again. But we have a few more months left in our study of 1 Thessalonians, and we're beginning a new section, and this section starts in chapter 4, verse 1. And it ends in chapter 5, I think around verse 22. So it's a very lengthy section of scripture, but it's what this contains is exactly what Paul really wants to communicate to the Thessalonian believers. Everything he has said in three chapters is leading to this moment, to this time in the letter. And so even though what he has said in chapters 1, 2, and 3 is important, he wanted to say those things. It really was preparing the mind and the hearts of the reader so that when he began to write these words, they would hear the message very, very clearly. They would understand exactly what he wants to communicate, and he wants to make sure they get it, that they understand, that they fully grasp what he is trying to say in these words. As you know, Paul really dearly loved this church. He cared for this church. He cared about their faith. He wanted to make sure that they were living a life glorifying the Lord. He wanted to make sure that they were truly believers. He wanted to make sure that even in the midst of the trials and the problems that they're facing as a church, trials and problems that he mentions in chapter 2, he wants to make sure that they are persevering, that they are enduring those things. And because sometimes a situation like that described in chapter 2 could destroy a church. It literally can. But if you're truly born again and you're truly a child of God, God is there with you. God will not leave you. He will not forsake you. And so he gives you comfort in the midst of the storm. He gives you peace in the time of trial. And so Paul is not able to physically visit with them. He's not physically able to go and be with them. And so as he writes this letter, he wants them to know he truly loves them, cares for them, and he cares about their faith, and he cares about their spiritual life. That's a very great concern for him. So he truly does love them and care for them, but it's one thing to say that. It's another thing to try to put content to what you're trying to communicate, or to the feelings that you want to share. Love, care. You also want to really, really help. And so what you have in chapter 4, verse 1 through chapter 5, verse 22 is exactly how Paul wants to help the Thessalonian believers grow in their faith. He's going to deal with some real issues. Some practical things that everyone faces, that we all deal with. He's going to deal with things that are very, very important, And he's doing it from the vantage point, from the angle of trying to help them grow in their walk with the Lord. That's why, really, you can entitle this whole section Spiritual Growth Pamor. Pastor Norman liked that for some reason. He liked that. He gave me a big like on the Facebook thing, you know. It's probably because we're using that kind of thing for church camp. So I think that was part of the reason. But that's exactly really what Paul's trying to do here. He's really focusing in on the fact that he wants these believers to grow and grow in their walk in the Lord and their understanding of the Lord. And so that's what he deals with. Now, what we're going to do today is look at just the first two verses. If you know how when you read a book, there's always an introduction chapter, a chapter that kind of introduces everything. You learn the characters and who the story's about, and then there's the development. Well, that's what happens here. In chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, you have the introduction. You have the thesis of what he wants to accomplish. Starting in verse 3 through the end of the section, he deals with different specific issues. So this week we're going to introduce the whole thing, and then next week we'll start looking at the different issues that arise. Let me just read these verses to you just again to set the scene for our time this morning. He writes in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, he says, "Finally then, brothers," and remember he uses that term over and over when he addresses them, "Finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus that as you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God, just as you are doing, that you do so more and more. For you know what instructions we gave you through the Lord Jesus." The key phrase that Paul uses to summarize the entire section of 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 1 to 5:22, is the phrase at the end of verse 1, "more and more." It's the idea of increasing. It's the idea of growing. It's the idea of going from one level to another. It's the opposite of staying in one spot or going backwards. We call it digressing, going backwards. And the way spiritual growth works, the way you have to understand the biblical teaching on spiritual growth, is that you never stay in one spot. You never stay still. You're either going, you're climbing, or you're digressing. And there's never a place where you arrive and say, "Oh, I have reached perfect holiness." There are some people who think that. There are some people who think that they've arrived. And so when they sin, you ask them, "I thought you arrived." "Well, I did. I'm perfect." "Well, you just committed a sin." No, that's not a sin. Since I've arrived, if I make a mistake, that's not a sin anymore. See, they usually get twisted logic there. But in reality, you never stagnate or stay at the same place. You either keep growing or you digress. And so Paul, when he encourages, he says, "We ask and urge you." Well, he's encouraging them to grow more and more. He wants them to make sure they keep their focus on the right path. He doesn't want them to digress, which will happen if they are not growing more and more. So that encouragement is not anything new. Actually, that is the normal type of the way to say it if you want to encourage someone to grow stronger in their relationship with the Lord. That's just how this works. Because they can't coast and just say, "Well, ride it out." Either you're growing or you're going the opposite direction. So this becomes a very critical issue for the Apostle Paul. If this church, it doesn't matter how many they have in terms of numbers. It doesn't matter what kind of facility they use. It doesn't matter how good the sound equipment is, even though they didn't have sound equipment then. It doesn't matter how good the power is. Well, they didn't even have electricity then. So, you know, it doesn't matter about those things. Some people think, oh, if we're going to have a church and we're going to have a strong church and a vibrant church and a church that really worships the Lord, we got to have a big stage and we got to have this and we got to have that. And it's nice to have those things. But you don't have to have those things. I was on the island of Boracay some years ago, and there was a church. It was in a grass hut, literally a grass hut. I walked in to that little church, and there was about maybe 20 seats and this little broken wooden pulpit. And the pastor, his family ran one of the small little hotels on the island, and he really wanted to – he felt God's call to ministry, and he wanted to be trained. And so he was a part of our training group at the time, and he asked me to preach at his church, and this little trike took me out to his place, to the church, and it was about maybe 10 people showed up. And so there were 10 empty seats, 10 people in seats, and it was just this grass little hut. And it was interesting, it rained, it started raining. And I thought, oh boy, you know. And they were pretty nice. I was, you know, I just had, was that was one my second time visiting here, I think. And second or third. And so I'm the American guy, you know, so they put all the fans on me, and I had about 3 fans on me, and I'm still sweating. You know, and I'm thinking, oh, my goodness. Lord's going to call me to a place like this, you know. And he did. So, so it doesn't matter all of those things. The key ingredient to a strong, vibrant church is not the building. It's not the people or the amount of people. It's not about, do you have all this high-tech equipment? And do you got, you know, singers who know how to lead a crowd? You know, it matters about the spiritual walk of those who attend the church. The depthness of character. The depthness of holiness. The depthness of how deep is your righteousness? How deep is your walk with the Lord? How much, how strong is your life with God? That's the key ingredient. Most likely for the Thessalonians, they didn't have a big building. They didn't have all this glamour stuff, glitzy stuff. They didn't need it. They probably met in somebody's home or someplace. Paul never talks about the facilities. He talks about their walk with the Lord. That's what he's focused on. And so he says that. We asked you. We've urged you. We've pleaded with you. Not like, you know, begging, but we've told you before when we were there. We're telling you now in this letter. I would assume Timothy did the same thing when he was visiting with you. We want you to excel. We want you to grow more and more. We want you to grow in your walk with the Lord. And so what does that look like? What does that look like? That's what Paul's going to deal with in this section. He's going to say, if you're really going to walk with the Lord, it's going to affect the practical areas of your life. Okay? It's going to affect different areas of your life. It's not just this, oh, yes. It's not growing deeply in, you know, to grow more spiritually mature is not about, you know, wiping out your mind and transcendental meditating, you know, and, oh, you know, oh, yeah, I'm getting closer to God. No, you're not. You're just doing something crazy. If you're really, truly closer to God, it's going to show in your daily life. I was at one time, I went to a Bible college. I went to a few of them. And one Bible college I attended, I was there for a year. This was in Canada. And it's cold up there. okay? And I was in about 3 hours away from Calgary, and or maybe an hour and a half, 2 hours away from Calgary, in this little town called Three Hills. And it, literally, they have three hills. Everything else is just plains, you know. And there's no mountains at all. And I actually walked to the Three Hills one time and saw it. And so the little town was named after that. And but there was a Bible college there. And supposedly, the Lord brought revival to that school. The Lord brought revival. That's what I was told. Because it supposedly it happened when I was there. I was a student there. And all of a sudden, I walk into chapel, and they decided not to do any preaching that day. It was typical to have a sermon, have a message, sing a few songs, have a message from a speaker, and then you're dismissed and go to class. They decided not to do that. They decided, it was decided upon overnight, that the Lord, in a rushing mighty spirit, whatever that means, is just bringing revival to the school. So this is the first time I ever heard about revival coming to a place without any preaching of God's word. It wasn't because of that. It was because of everybody was having this mystical feeling. And so what happened was people just started coming up to the platform and beginning to say whatever they wanted to talk about. I felt like I was in a counseling session. And they canceled classes for 3 days. But one professor, we talked to about it, he said, you know, if this revival thing is real, because there were many of us who doubted the premise of the whole thing. We never, you know, this seems too mystical. It's not how revivals we know that truly happened in the past, not following the pattern. And that one professor said, if this revival is real, the lives of these people will change in our daily walk. They won't think the same way. They won't do the same things. Their life will change. He said, if their life doesn't change after supposedly it ends, then it wasn't a real revival. And after 2 weeks, when the thing finally ended, about a week before, everybody went back to living the way they were living before. Didn't see much change. Professor said, you know, the people who weren't doing the assignments still weren't doing the assignments. You know, became an emotional roller coaster ride. What Paul deals with is true and real change and what it will take. Now, before we look at, you're wondering probably, how could I preach for 45 minutes or so on two verses? And they're very simply stated. It's because I'm going to go somewhere else. And we're still in the introduction here. So, honestly, chapter 4, verse 1 and 2 is very simple. And it won't take much explanation for you. But I want you to get this is a more detailed picture of someone else who wrote about spiritual growth and what they said. And I think it would be helpful just as dealing with the issue of what is spiritual growth and how does it look and how should it be encouraged. Peter wrote on the same issue. And if you go to 2 Peter, the book of 2 Peter, chapter 1, 2 Peter chapter 1, he deals with this. He deals with this issue. And I just want to start at verse 3. Peter, you know, this is his second letter that he's writing to these people. He's writing to people who are scattered throughout different churches in different cities throughout Asia Minor, modern-day Turkey today. So that was his audience. And so he's writing to the same group in 2 Peter. And he starts in chapter 1, verse 3. He says to them, now he's talking about our Lord, or may grace be and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And then he starts out in verse 3, his, speaking to God, his divine power. So God has all power, true? So God's divine power has granted to us. So that would be the readers of the letter. We're included in that by implication. So God, by his divine power, has granted to us everything, all things that pertain to life and godliness. Spiritual growth is wrapped up in the whole thing of life and godliness. That's another way of saying your spiritual growth. Everything you need for your life, for your he's not talking about just physical life here. He's talking about your spiritual life. And that which should, your spiritual life should produce, godliness. He has given you everything you need to do to live for him and live a holy and righteous life. You don't need to seek more of the Spirit's power. You don't need to say, Holy Spirit, come to me, zap me. I need the anointing, Lord. You don't need to pray for that stuff. When you were saved, when you were born again, God anointed you. You have everything you need. His divine power has granted to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. How did that come about? Through the knowledge of him who called you to his own glory and excellence. It was through knowledge of him. Knowledge of him represents salvation. When you were saved, born again, you received everything you need for life and godliness. I did? Yeah. So anybody saying that you got to pray for something more, go after something more, they're just mistaken. It's not scriptural. It's like saying, God, you didn't give me everything that I need. I want it now. And so you're really putting demands on God, and God's sitting there, standing, you know, he's looking at you going, I gave you everything already. Get it through your head. You have everything. So he, by his own glory and excellence, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises. Christ made a promise, I will give you the Holy Spirit. Christ made a promise, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Christ made a promise, I'm going to be with you. You are mine. I'm never going to leave you. Those are precious, very great promises. So that through those promises, you could become a partaker of the divine nature. That's being united with Christ. You know how it talks about in the Bible that we are in Christ? Your life is in him. You're either in him or out of him. That's it. And so if you're a true believer, you truly know the Lord, you're in him. And so by being connected to him, united with him, you have everything you need to live a holy and righteous life. Because you've escaped from the corruption that is in the world because of sinful desires. See, the world that you live in is sinful. And so you have to escape from it. How do you escape from it? Not by getting in a spaceship and flying off somewhere. It's the way you escape from it is by being truly born again. So what Peter talks about in verses 3 and 4, he's saying, if you are a true believer in Christ, you have everything you need. God has given you everything that you need to grow in your walk with him. Okay? So the key to spiritual growth is not in trying to seek more of the Holy Spirit. Pray more to receive more of the Holy Spirit. Usually the way the way it goes is you pray for the anointing. You want to receive the anointing. Sometimes people think that they can receive it through the coat jacket of Benny Hinn. Okay? When Benny Hinn brings people up on stage and he hits them with the coat, I don't know if you've ever seen that. YouTube. Just get on YouTube. You know what he supposedly is doing? Every time he hits you with the jacket, you're getting more of the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is transmitted through a coat jacket. I don't think so. But that's the ideology. That's the thinking in those circles. And so the whole point is you can't grow in the Lord. You may be a Christian, but you don't have everything you need. So you got to pray for it. You got to ask God, God, give me some more zap. I need more caliente, you know. More heavenly fire, you know, whatever you want to call it. So they have different terms for it. And so it becomes, and you say, well, how do you know you get it? Oh, you know how you know? You speak in a language that you have no idea what it is. It could be just, you know, how do you know that, you know, here's how it would work. Lord, give me more of your power. Hey, I just got it. I spoke in a language nobody knows. Neither do I. And they say, oh, that's a heavenly prayer language. Only God knows it. It's crazy. It just doesn't even make sense. Peter's saying, listen, when you were saved and born again, you received everything, okay? So, how does this practically work? Verse 5, for this very reason, here's what you have to do. You have to make every effort. And the word here is to supplement your faith with virtue. Virtue with knowledge. Knowledge with self-control. Self-control with steadfastness. Steadfastness with godliness. Godliness with brotherly affection. Brotherly affection with love. You start with faith, you end with love. And you say, well, how does this all work? Is it like adding more icing to a cake or something? Is that the imagery? It's not really that. It's the idea of building blocks, where one builds on another and builds on another and builds on another. You really, in the end, cannot separate these things. What you have to understand is that faith, virtue, knowledge, self-control, steadfastness, godliness, and brotherly affection with love, all of those are intricately connected with each other. That's the point. And what Peter is saying is these things should be in your life and demonstrated by your life, and they should be increasing at the same time. Your love should be deeper and stronger. Your faith should be deeper and stronger. Your knowledge about the Lord should be deeper and stronger. Self-control. You're guided by the Word of God and how much you know of the Word of God. You're steadfast. That means you can persevere through trials and hardships that's going to happen. Just get out on the go to the S-Lex. You're going to find it. That's a hardship. The N-Lex is a hardship. I've been there. And if you want some real hardship, when you go to Baguio, just go on Cannon Road. That'll give you some. That'll bring some sanctification in your life, you know. And so it's not about having ecstatic experiences. Woo, you know, I'm really getting deeper with the Lord. No, that's just feelings. It's about how you live your daily life. What controls your thinking? What controls your actions? What controls your motivations? And so spiritual growth, it deals with that area of your life, and that's the primary area of your life. It's not what you're doing just in a service for 2 hours. It's what you're doing every day of the week. How do you treat people? What do you think about the Lord? How much do you study God's Word? Are you really implementing God's Word in your life? Do you have true love in your hearts for others? These are the critical questions. And Paul in 1 Thessalonians is going to deal with specific areas. If you're going to spiritually grow, this area should look like this. And this area should look like this. He's going to get real specific. Real specific. When Peter's trying to do the same. He said, verse 8, if these qualities are yours, if they're a part of you. And note it, you didn't pray for this stuff. It came to you. You possess it at salvation. If these qualities are yours and are, what's the word? Increasing. It's not that you just possess them and say, oh, I'm glad I possess them. That's it. That's all I need. No, by nature, the inclination, the tendency is that they should increase. They keep you from being ineffective or unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, it really sometimes just gets me in a bad way when I hear a pastor preaching who has no idea about what the Bible says. I'm talking zero idea. And they promote themselves as God's called me to preach, and they have no idea about the Word of God. They know zero. And I've met a few. And it's very sad. That's nobody here, okay? So don't worry about that. But I've met a few. I met one guy like that in America. Man, he knew nothing. Claiming to be a preacher. And I'm thinking, you're very ineffective and unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. I never actually told him that, but that's what I was thinking. But Peter, that's what Peter's getting at. If you truly are born again, God's given you everything you need, and it should be increasing. These qualities, you should see them in your life. Verse 9, for whoever lacks these qualities, he's nearsighted. That's what I am. If I take my glasses off, you're blurry. I kind of know who you are, but it's all blurry. Glasses make it clear for me. And so he's saying you're nearsighted. You're walking around without the glasses on. You're not truly seeing. You're so nearsighted that you're blind. I mean, you're getting close to blind. I was told that if I don't wear my glasses or contacts, I can't drive. That's a law, legal thing. So Peter's using that idea. He's saying that if you don't see these things in your life and see them increasing, you're nearsighted or you're blind, and you've forgotten that you've been cleansed from your former sins. Now, it could be, too, that you could be claiming to be a Christian and not a real one. There are people like that. But there are those who also are true believers in Christ, but they are short-sighted. They forget. And usually God finds a way to remind them. That's called the discipline method. Hebrews 12. Therefore, brothers, verse 10, be all the more diligent. Here's the clincher. Here's the climax to Peter's teaching. Be all the more diligent, that means effort, put effort into it, to confirm your calling and election. Now just stop right there. Confirm your calling and election. He doesn't say your salvation, even though he means the same thing. He uses specific words, specific terms. It's the same idea that what Paul used in First Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 4. Brothers, we know that God has chosen you. And someday we're going to teach on this. We're going to let you understand about God's sovereignty and salvation. That's a heavy subject. Hopefully it doesn't make any of you mad to listen to it. But it's what one of these days we got to go through Scripture and tell you what that's all about. Because that's a very deep subject, and it creates a lot of questions. And that's rightfully so. And those questions are answered from Scripture. But anyway, what Peter's dealing with, he's saying, listen, God has called you, chosen you before the foundation of the world. That's what the Bible teaches. He's already taught them that, so he's not having to explain all of it in these verses. But he's saying when he mentions the word election and calling, that's what he means. He said God has chosen you before the foundation of the world to save you. To save your soul from hell, from eternal judgment. Now, in time, as you were born, brought into this world, you also repented from your sins. And as Paul would say in Philippians, end of chapter 1, I think, not only has God granted you repentance, he's granted that you will go through suffering. And so Paul makes a link that just as you know God is bringing suffering in your life to grow you, God also gave you the ability to repent from your sin. That's why even though you repent, it's not a human work. Because some people say, hey, I repented. I did something for my salvation. You responded in faith and repentance at the conviction of the Holy Spirit upon your life. But when you start studying Scripture, you're going to realize that the faith that you have and the repentance that you have is because the Lord gave it to you. Try to figure that one out. That'll blow your brain trying to figure that one out, but that's what the Bible says. So what Peter's dealing with is that he's saying you're saved, you're born again, God has called you before the foundation of the world and saved you in the moment of time. You repented from your sins, you're born again, truly in Christ, united with Him. So make that reality of your salvation, confirm it. Who do you need to confirm it to? Verify. The idea of confirm is verify, validate, make it valid. Who do you need to make it valid to? God? No, He already knows. Who do you need to make it valid to? Two groups. Yourself, okay, and everybody else. So confirm it. If you're growing in the Lord and you're spiritually walking in Him, that will be on display so that everyone will see. You don't have to put it on display. It'll be already on display. People will see that. They'll see the love that you have in your heart. They'll see you're growing in the Lord. They'll see the knowledge that God has given you for His Word. They'll see that you understand Scripture, and they'll be attracted to that. At least we hope they will. Some may actually be offended by it. But when you're growing in the Lord, it's obvious. It's not this private little secret little deal. And so it's just, you can't stop it from coming out, from being on display. And Peter is saying, if your life is like that, you're going to be able to confirm it. So be all the more diligent to do that. Because he says, if you practice these qualities, the qualities that he mentioned, guess what? You will never fail. For in this way there will be richly provided for you an entrance into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's because your life is saved and hid with Christ and God, and that your life is now different. It's changed. You have a new nature, a new heart, and your life is showing that it loves the Lord. It's just confirmation that true regeneration has taken place, and when the time comes for you to go home to meet your Savior, when He brings you home to glory, there's no doubt. You're not going to be one of the people in Matthew chapter 5 who say, Lord, or Matthew 7, Lord, can I come in? I'm knocking. No, I never knew you. You're not going to be one of those people. And Peter is saying the key to having confidence and peace and assurance of your own salvation is spiritual growth. That's why it's important. So therefore, he says in verse 12, I intend always to remind you of these things. I'm your conscience. Hear me roar, you know. And so though you know them and you're established, I think it's right, as long as I'm physically alive and in this body, before they cut my head off, I'm going to stir you up by way of reminder. You see, that's the prodding, you see. That's the pastoral prodding right there. It's like sticking it into your side, always reminding you that you have to grow in the Lord. Since I know, verse 14, that putting off of my body will be soon, the Lord Jesus made that clear to me. I know my life is getting near the end. But I will make every effort right now so that after my departure, when I die, you may be able at any time to recall these things. That's why I'm writing them down. This is Peter's final words, so to speak. And that's what he wants them to know. So that's really what spiritual growth is all about. Introduction over. Now for the sermon. back to 1 Thessalonians. And a couple little remarks to make. And then we're done. When Paul talks about growing here. I wrote this down in the outline. It's in the bulletin. What he addresses is two areas. When you think about what should motivate you to grow in your spiritual walk or spiritual life with the Lord, there's really two components of this. And this is what he deals with in these verses. Because remember, this is the introduction. He's setting it up. And then starting in verse 3, he deals with specific areas. He says, finally then, brothers, we ask and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do so more and more. As you receive from us how you ought to walk and to please God, we are encouraging you, urging you to do that more and more. So what is the first component? If you're going to think about what should motivate you to grow in the Lord, here's component number one. You should be willing to do the following. Number one, you should be able to receive encouragement from others to grow in the Lord. This is how God has the mechanism that God works to stir your heart up. This is exactly what these two components is exactly what Peter was doing when he wrote to his people in 2 Peter 1 that we just looked at. He was doing these two things. First, he's encouraging them, right? There's an encouragement. That's why he's writing what he's writing. He said, Paul says the same thing. We asked, we urged you. Just as you had already received from us in regards to how you should walk, how you should please God, the idea of walking and pleasing God is your spiritual growth, your spiritual life with the Lord. If you're truly walking with the Lord, it's like a sacrifice that's got a pleasing aroma. You're pleasing God. God will look on you with favor. It's the idea. It's that which you want. You want to please the Lord, right? We all should want to please the Lord. What pleases Him? Jumping up and down and getting hit by a suit coat? No. What really pleases Him is how you walk on a day by day basis. How you live your life on a day-by-day basis. And what Paul did was he encouraged them. He was the physical voice. He was the conscience, so to speak. He was the one that God used in their life to be the one to encourage them that they need to not forget about spiritual growth and that they need to be reminded of it and that they need to live it out. And they need to implement the truth in their life and show by their life that they are truly born again. And so for the one who is listening, for the one who is hearing, and we always encourage each other. So on the one hand, you're always the one who gives the encouragement. Sometimes you're the one who has to receive it. And you have to receive encouragement from others. If others would say, you know what, you need to grow in the Lord.
I don't need to grow in the Lord. I don't need to listen to you. I can do it my own way.
That's not receiving encouragement, right? That's being arrogant, rude.
I don't need to listen to you. I got a PhD.
Well, good for you. I don't care how many PhDs you got. I don't care how much education you have. I knew a guy who had an MDiv, a bachelor's degree, an MDiv, a master of theology, and a PhD. And he made a 4.0 or very high GPA. He was a straight A student. And he would, and you say, wow, look at all that education. And when he spoke to people, he would say, you know what? I want you to know I am a certifiable genius. Why don't you recognize that? That's how he treated people. And I'm like, dude, all that education's made you mad. It's not about your education. It's not about how wealthy you are. I want you to grow in the Lord. You don't talk to me that way. I'm a rich man. I don't care how much you got. I don't care if you're richer than Bill Gates. When you die, you're not taking any of that with you. So just leave it to me, okay? Hey, when you encourage a rich person to grow in the Lord and they don't like it, well, don't expect to be in their will. But if you're going to grow in the Lord, there are going to be people that God's going to use in your life to be the ones to encourage you. okay? And you can't get prideful at it. You got to receive it. That's what Paul's telling. If Paul's starting this way, because he's going to be dealing with very specific issues. I mean specific issues. And it's not going to be, he's going to deal directly with these people about these issues. And the tendency would be, you know, these people are reading that going, I forget Paul. Who needs that? You know, where's the fluff when you want it? You know, where's the light and fluffy stuff? I actually heard about a person who said to a pastor, I want you to preach a sermon that makes me feel good. It's all about feeling good. Stop preaching verse by verse from the Word of God because that doesn't make me feel good. Well, it's not about you feeling good. It's about you living according to the truth. And so there may be times where the encouragement may be okay, but sometimes the encouragement may be more direct. And you got to be willing to receive it. And the inclination will be to defend yourself. Somebody called that the inner lawyer. Your lawyer shows up and defends you. And it just becomes a mess. You got to be willing to accept the encouragement. And that's what Paul's doing. He's saying, we've asked you, we've urged you in the Lord. You've received it from us in the past when we were there and when Timothy was with you. And we want you to do so more and more now. You're receiving this letter and you're reading it for the first time. Don't pitch it away at this point. So number one, you got to receive encouragement from others, okay? You got to be willing to receive it. Then you got to receive the instruction. And these are so closely together. See, the encouragement idea looks at the motivation that the person who's trying to encourage you, the motivation they have for beginning to say something to you. Think about it this way. You're doing something wrong, okay? Let's don't do it that way. Let's use a different illustration. You are blinded. You got a blindfold on, and you're walking. What you don't realize is that there's a cliff coming up, okay? So you're just, you know, you're just having fun, but if you keep doing what you're doing, you're going to die. You're going to fall off the cliff. So somebody else sees you falling off the cliff or getting ready to fall off a cliff. So they're going to sit there and go, should I say something? If I say something, they may be offended. At some point, this is an extreme example or extreme illustration. You don't worry about what the person's going to think about you. You're trying to save their life. So the encouragement aspect is the motivation to speak up, to say something. So the person who's trying to encourage you has to decide if they're going to say something or not. And they should say something at that point, and so they do. So, but when they speak, they say words, content. So you got to think about the content of what they're actually saying, and you have to think about the motivation for why they said that in the first place. You got to be willing to receive both. The encouragement deals with the motivation. The instruction is the actual content. So not only do you need to receive encouragement, but you got to receive the instructions, what they actually say. Paul would say it this way. Just as you had received from us, what is the content? What did we specifically deal with? How you ought to walk and to please God. We dealt with that issue, that critical issue in your life. Verse 2, you know what instructions we gave you through our Lord Jesus. When we were there and we preached to you, ministered to you, we gave you specific instructions about how you are to walk and to please God. We dealt with specific areas in your life. And we did it with the motivation that we wanted to encourage you. We weren't trying to make you look bad. We weren't trying to put you down. We weren't trying to shame you. We weren't trying to do anything. We had no ill intentions towards you. But we knew by what God had called us to do, we have to encourage you to do that. And at times, you know, it could be more indirect and it could be more direct. There are times when it's okay to be indirect in trying to help someone. But sometimes you have to be direct. Otherwise, they don't get it. We had a guy that we were trying to work with, our TEIA team, and we were indirect for like 4 months, just thinking that he would catch it, you know? That didn't work. Totally oblivious. Woo! And then we became direct, and then he got upset. Okay. One way he doesn't even see it. Well, I'm not the problem. And then the other way, when you are direct, because you have to be, that inner lawyer came out. Defending himself, justifying himself. It's hard to, you know, it's hard to deal with someone who's not spiritually growing. So you got to be willing to receive the encouragement and receive the instruction. And that's what Paul's going to do, starting in verse 3 to the end of verse chapter 5, verse 22. It's all about your spiritual growth, walking and pleasing God. The purpose is to excel more and more. That's the goal that he wants for the for these people. So he's going to provide them detailed instructions on how to do that in specific areas of their life. They have to be willing to receive it and follow it. If they don't, Lord, help them. So that's how spiritual growth works. It's not about an ecstatic experience, you know. Don't put your finger in the light socket expecting to have spiritual growth. It won't work. Don't just say, oh, I watched this TV preacher and woo! He says, touch the TV screen and, you know. It doesn't work with these, you know, these new modern deals anyway, screens that they make. It did back in the old days because you could actually feel, you know, sometimes you could feel a little static charge because it's just a TV. And those, you see, and they play all of that. Did you feel the static charge when you touched the screen? That's the Lord talking to you. Oh, my goodness. You see, it's like, man. No spirit with Samsung. Man, you know, nothing there. The TV has no zap and their phones explode. You know, go figure. But spiritual growth has everything to do with your walk with the Lord. And you got to receive the instructions that are communicated to you. However the Lord chooses to give you those instructions. And it'll be instructions that come from Scripture. Not just ecstatic experiences. So, for the next few weeks, really through November, we're going to be dealing with growing in Christ. Growing in Christ. Paul had prayed that the Thessalonians would grow. And now he's going to say, here's how I want you to grow. Here's what God's leading me to tell you and deal with. So, anticipate that. And it'll be an interesting time in the Word. About what Paul says and what issues he brings up. So, is that helpful? So, thank you for making it through the heat and no power, all this stuff. But I think we can learn together about what God would want us to do. Let's pray. Lord, we are so thankful of your blessings to us each and every day. And Lord, for this place, you know, that we can meet and that we can worship you and gather. Lord, it is a blessing. And Lord, we may sweat at times. We may want a fan on us. But Lord, it's good, your blessings to us. Lord, no matter how many people we are, how small or large, the reality is, how deep is our walk with you? It should be deep. Should be rich. Lord, I pray that it will be. Lord, I pray for the rest of our day. It'll be to your glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.